closer. I come to life when you pull me closer.
Hi, I am just so glad each one of you guys are here. I was like just praying for service this morning, and this verse came to mind. So I'm just going to read it because I just think God's word is awesome. It's in Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. And how it's so important that we can meet together. And just last Monday, it was amazing. There was actually between 55 and 60 kids at Bible study. And we finished Romans 16. And it was just like, just however we do, the pastor is working on COVID clusters. And what that is so we can help and make people feel as comfortable as they want, or they feel led to do. But if you could fill out those, if you're interested in meeting with people, I just think we have to somehow, if it's with your neighbor, if it's whoever, we need to make sure that we're together and spurring each other on, because I don't know, I need people. And so even if it's your neighbor or whoever, we want to get these groups to go so we can study scripture. So that is what those COVID things are. Next week, we are at the Pioneer Grounds. So make sure you come, bring your camping chairs, blanket. And if you want to stay and have a picnic, you can bring a little picnic basket. Should be just a fun time. Kids are going to do something special with Tina, and it should just be a rocking out time, right?
Right on.
I don't know if you guys are doing worship, but I know there's a bunch of them doing worship on the stage, so we want everybody to be there. All right, and then the last thing is in 2 weeks, Pastor Michael has set up, so the men are going to have one more cornhole tournament. And it's everybody's against Charlie. Who was Charlie's team last time? Who was his teammate? Phil? Okay, everybody's against Charlie and Phil.
I think we should tie their hands behind their, make them throw with their teeth.
Oh, your toes. You can throw with your toes.
With your toes, yeah.
You guys are too good. All right, we are going to pray for offering and then lead it into worship team. All right. Dear Father, I just thank you so much. I thank you that we can meet together and that our church building is still open. I pray that you'll be with Jeff today as he speaks the message, and just help him be anointed by you, the Holy Spirit, just to lead. Pray that you'll be with the worship team as they are just pouring out their hearts and souls in this, just to bring this church into worship to glorify you. I thank you, and I pray that you'll be with Tina downstairs as she teaches the children. And that the giving, how amazing it is that people still keep giving to the church, and the building is going up without a hitch. The funding keeps coming in. We thank you for how amazing you are, and just that we can be here today. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen. If you'd like to stand up, we'll start our worship. I think it's pretty cool that Kay's got like 60 kids coming to Bible study. That's some serious kingdom building right there. We're going to do a little bit of that right now.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil how we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our veins. Now we
banjo, Doug.
Oh, either. His love is deeper than the sea. His mercy is unfailing. His arms a fortress for the weak.
Place of shelter in our time of need. We just thank you for that. We just thank you that no matter what we go through, we can always lean in and rely on you, Jesus. We just thank you for this. We just ask for a blessing on the service to come, and bless Jeff as he brings the message. In Jesus' name, amen.
I think this thing's on. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's been a while since I've been in front of people with being in lockdown. I haven't been in front of students since I don't know when, except for on a computer over Zoom. Has anybody used Zoom or anything like that? Has anybody done a Zoom? So you know a little bit about what my world looked like. Can you turn me down just a little? My world looked a little bit differently this spring than it's ever looked. And it really made me, all of us have so much more time. At least the Morris family has a lot more time because we're not running around as much as we usually are with our kids and everything. We're still running around quite a bit, but not as much. And everything that I'm going to be sharing this morning is really just an overflow of what God's been teaching me over the last several months I think we all share some similar situation right now. I think the whole world is in a situation that we can all relate to each other, probably better now than we've ever been able to, because there's times in our lives where maybe we can relate to somebody because they're going through something similar, maybe we can't. But I think to some degree, all of us can relate to what we're all feeling and what we've all been going through. So I'm gonna pray before we get started, and there is some notes. I don't know if you picked them up, but if you wanna go grab them while I'm praying, you can. God, thank you so much, Lord, for this morning, and thank you so much, God, for this time that we have together. I just pray, God, for your blessing over the service. I pray for your blessing over the people that are in this room, over their families, over their marriages, over their children, over their grandchildren. I just pray your blessing as we talk about blessing and abundance and what that looks like in our lives. I pray that we would just get a glimpse of your glory and how you want to reveal your glory in each one of us. In the name of Jesus, amen. So I'm really struggling with what to give a title to this. So I came up with broken cisterns because that's what I feel like probably all of us are maybe feeling like. And if you know what a cistern is something that holds water. And I feel like probably a lot of us are in that feeling where I feel like things are just kind of broken right now. And we feel like we've lost something. So that's what I'm going to be talking about this morning. And I'm going to be talking about blessing and abundance. And what that looks like. And if we were to talk about blessing right now, for a lot of us right now, it doesn't feel like there's much blessing right now or much abundance. And what does it even mean as people who follow Jesus? What does it even mean to pursue blessing and to pursue abundance? I really gave that a lot of thought as I was preparing this message this morning because I think about my own life and some of the things that I've been through with my family and individually and thinking about blessing and thinking about what abundance looks like. And what does it mean when somebody says they're blessed? I mean, what does that even mean? What is it that we're really pursuing? Well, if you want to turn your Bibles, I'm going to be flipping all over the place today. I'm not really going to settle in on one place, so you're going to have to play, what was the game you played when you were in vacation Bible school? The Bible racing where you picked out a verse and you had to get there as fastest, and the person always chose, something out of Habakkuk, and you're like, what's Habakkuk? I'm going to be reading, first of all, in John chapter 10, verses 10 and 11. This is Jesus speaking to a crowd, to his disciples, and he says this. He says, "The thief comes only to steal, to kill, and destroy. I have came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." So I would say right now, if thinking about that verse in the context of that verse in our situation, I would say right now that our current situation has caused a lot of us to feel like that something has been taken from us. Most of us would say that dreams are planned. You think back in January and February before all this happened, dreams and plans we had for 2020 are kind of out the window. And I think that a lot of us probably feel that way. And probably for a lot of us, dreams and plans that you had, maybe for your family or your kids. I think about my own son who's a senior, and the day they're getting ready to play in their section championship basketball game, and that morning they told they weren't going to be able to play because of COVID. And so a lot of our dreams and desires that we had have been killed or even destroyed. The rug literally has been pulled out from underneath us. And so where is the blessing and abundance in all of this? And a lot of us probably we're really trying or striving to get back to the way it was. And maybe for a season, we'll see a sense of normalcy. But I don't know if that's what God really wants. And that's what I want to challenge you to think about this morning. Is that what God really wants? Does God really want us to get back to the way things were? We're so preoccupied with trying to get back what we've lost. And I hear this constantly with a lot of my friends who are teachers and coaches. they feel like they've lost so much, and it's like we got to try and make up for what we've lost, and we're trying to get back to that. And the problem with that is that when we're so preoccupied with what we've lost, a lot of us are probably missing out on a new thing that God wants us to step into. And so I've been actually with about 5 different guys. We're doing this little text group where we're reading through the Bible together, and we're on day 60. That is the longest I have went reading the Bible straight in my lifetime. It's been really cool to have this accountability with these 5 other men that we're texting every day when we get it done. And it's like this competition. Lance Rock already texted me this morning that he was done. And I didn't get to text first that I got done before him, because he texted at like 8 something and I was already done at 7 because I was preaching it. And I was like, well, I got to have my time first. So we all kind of have bragging rights on who texts first to say they're done. And I've been reading through the Old Testament, and I'm going to kind of land in the New Testament or Old Testament for just a little bit, and then I have this thing that I'm going to do with you. Probably wondering what this is over here. This is going to be my kind of ending. You'll know I'm ending my message when I get over here, okay? So that'll help. You'll be like, okay, he's almost done. So reading through the Old Testament, it's really weird when you read through the Old Testament, because you're reading about this people group that's just kind of wandering around, and they're really without purpose. Or a place. And God chooses a man named Abram. Okay? He chooses this man named Abram, and he says he's going to bless him, and he's going to make him into this great nation to bless all the peoples of the earth. And actually, we see this in Genesis chapter 12. We see God's blessing over Abraham and his descendants that would define them for generations. And I'll read that to you. It says, God speaking to Abraham, it says, "Now the Lord said to Abraham, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make you of a great nation. For I will bless you and make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and who dishonors you I will curse. And in all and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." And I think this is just a real interesting blessing, because as we think about what does it mean to pursue blessing? What does abundance look like? I think a lot of us have the misconception that blessing is tied to an individual. What God's saying here is that blessing is more than just something that an individual experienced. Blessing is something that is an overflow of what God is doing in our lives into the lives of others. And what's really crazy, if you think about this for just a second, as we bless others, the Bible says that as we bless others, we actually are blessing God. Have you ever thought about that? That you have the opportunity to bless God? Like, I think sometimes that all I'm thinking about, my one-track mind, God bless me, God bless me, God bless me, God bless me. And the purpose of blessing is not just for me. The purpose of blessing is for there to be an overflow, an outpouring of my life into the lives of others so that I can bless others and ultimately bless God. That's what blessing, the purpose of blessing is. However, it's interesting because this blessing, I got to get rid of these, they're in my way. However, this blessing that God gives does not mean that there's absence of trouble. And I think that's what a lot of us probably are experiencing right now. It's like, okay, God, I want blessing in my life. I know that I'm supposed to be a blessing, but how do you wrestle and how do you embrace all that we're going through right now? Abraham's descendants, who will be referred to as the nation of Israel, are eventually enslaved by another nation, okay, Egypt, who do not worship the one true God. But God is true to the promise of blessing this group of people and honors the covenant and raises up a man to deliver the nation of Israel into the promised blessing. And that's where I'm going to pick up just a little bit. So if you want to flip and kind of follow along with me, I'm not going to really be reading a long passage of scripture, but I'm going to kind of, like I said, be jumping around. I'm going to look at Exodus chapter 3. And Exodus chapter 3, verses 7 and 8, here's where God raises up this man named Moses. And most of us are familiar with Moses, or at least Charleston Heston. So, and some of you are like, I can't even believe he knows who that is. So, Exodus chapter 3, verses 7 and 8. This is what the Lord says to Moses. He says, "The Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people." He's calling this people that's enslaved in this nation, Egypt. He's calling, that's his people. He's saying, they're my people. Okay, I've seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I've heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their suffering, and I have come down. It's interesting, because a lot of times we're trying to find our way to God when we don't understand. It's actually God who found us and found a way for us. And I've come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land into a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the land of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, and the Mosquito Bites. So you got, God's raising up this man, Moses, to deliver them out of slavery. And so you go back to Genesis 12, you're kind of wrapping your head around this, like, okay, he's going to bless them, he's going to make them this great nation, and now they're found in this, in the current state of things, they're in slavery. And not just for like the short amount of time we feel like we've been enslaved in our houses because of quarantine, but this is for 400 years. They're in slavery to this nation, Egypt. And so the next 9 to 10 chapters, God's going to start working on delivering his people out of slavery. Get to Exodus 13, which I'll flip over to now. And I thought this was pretty profound because this is the part we don't like. Because God and the way he wants to bless, and the Old Testament really is just a picture of God's character and how he works and his ways and how he can be trusted and relied upon. And Exodus chapter 13, verse 17, this is where God introduces to them something called the wilderness. And that wasn't part of the promise. When the promise was God was going to deliver them into the land, this promised land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and there was no mention of the wilderness at that point. And so now you're kind of here in verse 17, it says, when Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them by the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest the people change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt. But God led them around by the way of the wilderness. And they're probably thinking, the wilderness? Wait a minute, what's this? And so now they're going to go to a place that they weren't promised. They were going to go a different place because God had made no mention of the wilderness. And so God introduces them to the wilderness. Now you have to understand something about this journey from Egypt to the promised land. It really only should have took them about 2 weeks. But we know that it took 40 years. And so it's interesting when you think about this, and I think the main reason for this is God knew what they were prepared for. They had been in slavery for 400 years. They weren't prepared for the war that they were going to have to wage to take on the promised land. They were this kind of cowardice people that really didn't know God and his character. And God was about to show up and show him that he could be trusted and show that he could be relied upon. And so that's what God is doing. So the main reason for this is the people had only known slavery for the last 400 years. Now they were free and they had to learn to trust God who rescued them out of bondage. He knew what they weren't ready for. And a lot of time God knows what we're not ready for, and God has to take us through something to prepare us for the thing that he wants us to step into. And so they witnessed God rain down plagues on Egypt, which led Pharaoh to let them go. Then God would part the Red Sea. Now imagine all this happening. You're the nation of Israel. You're being rescued out of Egypt. You see God rain down these plagues. You see him split the Red Sea and destroy the nation of Egypt, or Pharaoh and his armies. And then after this, they experience God's presence. Now imagine this, like being at the mountain of God and experiencing the very presence of God. They received his commandments. They would even see, be led by a cloud of smoke by day and a pillar of fire by night. But they would struggle for 40 years to embrace their new identity. For the next 40 years, they would struggle against this. Even of all the things they've seen. I mean, I think sometimes I'm like, if I had seen the Red Sea split, there's no way I wouldn't have trusted God. If I had seen God on the mountain and he gave us the commandments, I wouldn't forget about God. But what were the Israelites doing as soon as God had given them the commandments? They had already set up an idol, a golden calf, and were worshiping and literally, you know, cutting themselves and worshiping an idol, even though they had seen all these things. So God was doing something in this wilderness to teach them to trust him. And so I go to Numbers 14, which is actually, Numbers 13 and 14 is one of my favorite passages now. And it's not just because I'm a math teacher. My wife always says I make that joke, but that one actually made sense to make. Because you get this nation, and they're getting ready to go to the promised land, and not much time has passed. You're not even close to, I don't know how much time has passed at this point. When I was reading through it, I remember I looked at it, but it wasn't as much time as the 40 years that they were going to experience. And God had brought them to the edge of the promised land, and he had sent spies into the promised land, and they freaked out because there were these giants and these people that they didn't think they could defeat. And so here's what they do in chapter 14. The nation of Israel, it says, they're grumbling against Moses and Aaron, and the whole congregation said to them, would that we have died in the land of Egypt, or would that we have died in the wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into the land to fall by the sword? So God has already promised this land, and there was only two people that said, hey, we can do this, we can take it, because God has promised this. But they were freaking out, they were complaining, and they were lusting after what they had in Egypt. They were still consumed by what they had in Egypt. In fact, there was many times in Scripture says, why did you bring us here? We had bread and we had as much meat as we wanted to eat when we were in the land of Egypt. And they complained continually for these 40 years and didn't get the lessons. The whole purpose of the wilderness experience is to know who our source is. It's to understand who our source is. And right now, I think probably for a lot of us, we probably feel like we're in this kind of wilderness experience. So we don't forget about God. When you get the grapes, you don't forget about God. When you get to the promised land, we don't forget about God. See, the nation of Israel, when at the mountain of God, would still forget about God. As I said, they had set up an idol already, even though the commandments were coming down. And what was the first commandment? Don't worship any other, put any other gods before me. We were meant for blessing and flourishing. And what we need to understand about God's character is that it's not limited to a specific location. And it's not limited to a specific circumstance or certain situations. Jesus said there will be trouble in this world. And our quality of life will be our ability to trust God, not just on the mountaintops, but in the valleys of the wilderness. That's what our quality of life is rooted in. It's not just on the mountaintops, but in the valleys. I was really struggling with a verse kind of to tie this piece together as I get into the last part of the message. And I was reading my scripture reading this morning was Psalms 61, and it talked about God being the rock. And I thought of this verse, Matthew 7, verses 24 and 27, and Jesus speaking. He just gave the Sermon on the Mount, and he says, everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on the house, and it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rains fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it all. And that's probably what a lot of people are feeling right now, that there was this great fall because people had their houses built on the sand instead of built on the rock of Jesus Christ. So go back to our opening verse. Jesus says, I've came to give life and give it abundantly. But he goes on, and I love the second part of that verse. It's really cool. And I was thinking about this as a lead-in to what I want to show you here this morning. Jesus says, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I've came that they may have life and have it abundantly. But he goes on to say in verse 11, he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. And I want you to think about that, because as we think about a full life and an abundant life and what blessing really means for us, so many of them in this room right now don't even know who Jesus is, who that good shepherd is, or at least have that experience right now where a full life can be found. And if you want to turn to Psalms 23 for just a moment, I'm just going to pick out a verse or two here to read to you. And then I have a couple points that I want you to write down. Psalms 23 for just a moment. I love verse 1. It says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And can we truly say that we know the Lord is our shepherd, that we shall not want, regardless of our circumstances? Because if you go down to verse 4 and 5, it says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, even though we're in the wilderness right now, even though a lot of us feel like things have been taken from us, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, because that's what he was doing with the nation of Israel. When they were in the wilderness, he was preparing a table before them in the presence of their enemy, because the whole time they were in the wilderness, you know what the rest of the nations were thinking? They were thinking, please don't come, please don't come, because they had heard about all the things that this God had done for this nation, and they were trembling in fear, and they spent 40 years wasting time when they could have went in and taken the land because God had already shown himself. So blessing and a full life are not found in our circumstances. Because when God prepares a table in the presence of our enemy, he's anointing our head with oil so that our cup overflows. That's what blessing is God anointing us and filling us even in the valley, not being found in our circumstances, but being found in knowing Jesus is our shepherd. Even in the middle of a pandemic right now, we all feel like we've lost something. And all of us, I get this, because we're so obsessed because we feel like we've lost something. And we're trying to get back what we think we've lost. but maybe God is trying to show us what we can truly gain. Maybe we should be considering where God is actually positioning us as the church right now. That he wants to do something amazing right now in the church. Like, I think the position of the church right now is in a greater position than it's been in the last 100 years. We have a chance to speak into to the culture right now because people are hurting, they're lost. And I know we all feel the tension in our culture right now, and I'm not talking about how you feel about masks. I don't care. And I'm not talking about how you feel about the presidential election. I don't give a rip. I don't care about what you think about Black Lives Matters. We need to be just as passionate about our relationship with Jesus Christ and fired up about the fact that people are lost as we are about those other things. Because we can get fired up about that stuff, but we can't get fired up about the fact that we're walking around and probably every day, most of us are around people that are lost. But we get fired up about things that aren't going to last instead of getting fired up about the thing that's going to matter 100 years from now. And so I think about the tension that we're all feeling because it comes down to one thing. Do people around us know Jesus as the Good Shepherd, and do we get to be a blessing? Because that was the call of the blessing. The call of the blessing was not just for us. The call of the blessing was for us to bless the world, to bless the nations. And that's the opportunity that we have before us right now. I'm going to close with this, Jeremiah 2:13, and I'm going to have you write down 2 points. This is later, and a prophet comes, and he's referring back to the nation of Israel and what they had been through. And he says, and this is God speaking to the nation of Israel, says, "My people have committed 2 sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of living water, and have dug their own cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water." So there's 2 things here that I'd write down if I were you. Number one, we have forsaken God. A lot of us have been on that mountaintop for so long, and it's so easy on the mountaintop to just enjoy the blessing and keep it to ourselves and to forget about God, because that's what Israel did. Don't think we can't do it. If the nation of Israel, who just saw the Red Sea split, who were just at the mountain of God and witnessed the presence of God, if they were able to forsake God, how easy do you think it is for us to forsake God? We forsake God on the mountaintop and especially in the valley, because in the valley is where we're freaking out. The valley is like, "Where's God? I don't understand this. Where are you at? Why are you not listening to me right now?" And it's in the valley that I think most of us really struggle right now in forsaking God and knowing that God is still on the throne. I love what the psalmist says. He says, God is still on his throne. In Habakkuk 3, God is still in his, he's still on the throne, he's still in the courtroom, and he's reigning sovereign regardless of what situations we're facing right now. And the second thing is we've dug our own cisterns. How often do we run to cisterns that leave us thirsty or all dried up? Okay, now I want you to think about a cistern because it says cisterns that are broken and cannot hold water. So think about a well that's dried up. Okay, or think about a cistern that would not be able to hold water. And how often do we run to those things? And I was trying to think about John chapter 4, Jesus meets this woman at the well. This is an interesting story because this woman goes and Jesus asks for a drink and she's kind of confused. Why is this man, a rabbi, asking me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink of water? And she said, and Jesus responds, he says, "If you would have asked me, I would have given you springs of living water." And so I think about the springs of living water that Jesus offers to us. But what relationships do we have with the world right now that are leaving us thirsty, empty, and dry inside? Think about the relationships with people. Think about this woman. She had a relationship with six different men. She had been caught in adultery, and Jesus calls her out and sees how empty she is and says, "Here, I am the spring of living water." What relationships do we have that leave us thirsty? I think of people, I think of relationships, I think of stuff, I think of pleasure, all these things that we really attach to in the world that leave us thirsty and dry. So I have kind of a object lesson here for you this morning. And so just imagine this is a cistern, okay? And this one doesn't have holes in it, so this one's going to be able to hold water. But our cistern is kind of the vessel that we put stuff in. In our life. So these ping pong balls just represent things in our lives, okay? This could be anything. These could be hopes. These could be dreams. Oops, I missed. This could be anything. That sounds really cool. Sorry, I get amused by simple things. So this is just everything. These are our burdens. These are addictions. It can be sins. I keep losing ping pong balls. That's okay. I put a lot of extra because I knew this was going to happen. So this is just the things we feel in our life, okay? So this cistern represents you, all right? And we fill our life with all kinds of things. But the problem is, no matter how much we try to put in our life, there's still gaps. So everybody can see that, right? There's still gaps. There's things. No matter. You can try as much as you want to try and fill your life, but you're never going to have the full abundant life that God promised. There's no way. Everybody can clearly see. Everybody agree that there are gaps here, that we're not going to be able to fill with just another thing, with another activity, another dream, another desire, another pleasure, more sin or addiction or whatever it is. We try and fill our lives with these things. But what the Bible talks about is that Jesus is a spring of living waters. And so as I've been kind of diving into what I think God was really trying to get through to the nation of Israel, to learn to trust Him, to not only trust Him with their past, okay? They had trusted God with their past. He had delivered them out of slavery, and I think that's the first step that a lot of us make. We're able to trust God for the forgiveness of sins and that we're going to get to go to heaven, but we have a hard time trusting God in our present for our future. I'm going to say that again. We have a really hard time trusting God in our present for our future. Most of us don't. We want to kind of keep control of what we think we have control of, which is just the illusion of control. So here's our life with these ping pong balls in there. And now imagine, you know, as we've trusted Jesus as our Savior, we allow God, who's the spring of living waters, to flow into our lives and pour over our lives. And this is the anointing of God. And just think of the anointing of God. He says our cup, He wants our cup to overflow. And as God's anointing comes into our life, here's what starts to happen. I was supposed to put the bowl around it, but I forgot to do that, okay? But just imagine the bowls around it catching the balls, okay? And so as you see right now, it's really cool. I think this part's really cool because as you've consistently started to allow God to anoint your life, for His anointing to come into your life, for His Spirit to fill you, okay? So God's Spirit, He fills in those gaps, right? Now, from a distance, if you're all the way back there, and I saw another pastor do this, this is not my idea. I stole this from another pastor who did this object lesson, which really, I thought it was a great thing, so I was like, I got to use this. And so as you see this, probably if you were way back there, Tom way in the back, probably all that you see is the ping pong balls, right? You don't really see the water, right? It's not until we completely let our lives be filled by God. Is because still the thing that's the focus is the ping pong balls, the stress of our life, the problems of our life, the desires, the things. It's not God that Tom's seeing in our lives. He's seeing all the other stuff. It's not until we fully let God in. Oh, don't worry, I got more. This is a spring of springs of living water. We're not going to run out, okay? So hold on here. And so now you just got these ping pong balls on the top, and I could pour more water and get them all out, and you get the point. And so now we have this cistern. And the point of it is God is a spring of living water that never runs dry. And so He can I'm not going to do this. I'll do it next service because I'm supposed to have a bowl under this. But I would keep pouring water, and what you would see is that God's overflow is still affecting the parts of our life. But the thing that Tom sees now, he said he doesn't see the ping pong balls anymore. He sees a cistern full of water, and it's overflowing in every area of our life. And the thing is when you do that, and this is the part that I really liked, and I'm going to steal from him. This pastor made the point, says, the thing is even though, and when we're in that place where we're allowing God to overflow in our lives, even when we try, no matter how hard we try, that thing that we're trying, that burden that we're trying to put back in our life, God's not going to let it take over, okay? Because His presence, His anointing is in us to overflow in us. And that's really what God wants. That's what God wants. When He's talking in Jeremiah 2, verse 13, He says they've dug cisterns. And I thought about that. We've dug our own cisterns that don't hold water. See, God wants us to have a cistern that holds water. And when we try and do it in and of ourselves, He wants us to be, I read a verse this morning, it says He wants us to dwell in His tent. And that's just an amazing thing, to be in God's presence. He wants us to dwell in His tent. So no matter what you're facing right now, I'm going to close in prayer. I just want you to think about everything that we've been going through and think about blessing in a completely different way. I hope this gives you a good visual to think about how God wants to bless us. He really wants there to be an overflow of our cup. And that blessing can occur even right now in a circumstance that seems really out of our control and seems really hopeless. But God wants us to be the hope to the nations. Pray with me. God, thank you so much for this morning. I thank you so much, God, for you being the spring of living waters, a well that will never run dry, that we can go to the well and that we can be thirsty no more. And help us to realize that blessing is not just about what fills our cisterns. It's about the overflow of the cistern. It's about you overflowing, not only affecting our lives, but affecting our relationships, affecting everything around us. Because when there's an overflow, people around us will be touched. Their lives will be touched by the person of Jesus. And I pray that that's our mission, that we would go and be a blessing to the nations. In the name of Jesus, amen. Well, you guys are welcome to go fellowship or exit this way, I guess. I don't know the protocol. So you have to go out this way, okay?
I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed from a ruin to treasure. I've been given